Yeah, my name is Ilaria Cristoforo. I'm part of the University of Wales, Trinity St. David. The research I'm going to present today is based on an auto-ethnographic methodology, which I did last summer. And my research question was to explore meanings connected with the sky as it reflects in water. So the motivation is due to the overlooked acknowledgement of the cosmological presence of the sky in the water when interpreting archaeological and archaeoastronomical sites. Indeed, the reflective quality of water has visually a very dramatic impact, especially when it's combined with the light of celestial phenomena. The quality of water of reflecting celestial bodies is just one of the possible perceptions related with water. My investigation focused on auto-ethnographical consideration with the aim of creating parallels with symbolism and narratives on sky water reflection as embodied by past societies. So I'm going to introduce my methodology, which is a reflexive phenomenology. Then I will expose some archaeological examples on which apply the research. And some resulting theme, which I draw from my consideration, which are continuity, delimitation, manipulation, duality, dissolution, and ritual of initiation and symbolic death experiences. And finally, I will draw some conclusions. So, my methodology. So I use auto-ethnography by gathering reflexive consideration in form of notes, poems, drawing, and photographs. So during my exploration, I record a description of the ecosystem around me in terms of place, time, significant phenomena happening, as well as of my sensation, thought, emotions in response to environment. The observation will focus on qualities and properties of the phenomena in consideration and were achieved through the practice of phenomenology. The attempt was to establish a dialogue with the elements and to grasp their essence in line with Maurice Merleau-Ponty's statement of the primary aim of phenomenology. However, as the body mind of the receptors of the researcher are never elemental but always culturally conditioned, my role of researcher was of inevitable impact on the research process. Therefore, as I have a background in astronomy, I was attempting to keep aside my scientific knowledge in order to achieve a more spontaneous relationship with the natural world through a primitive logic as discussed by Lucien Levy-Brull. So I found that's the theory and the practice I used was to empty myself of distracting thought and achieve a state of transparency. I focus my attention on my breathing and try to keep my mind open and receptive. Then I give myself time to establish a relationship of empathy with the water skyscape or whatever element and allow its different qualitative dimension to be explored. So I was aware of the input from the environment by seeing, listening, smelling. I thought the visual sense was the one most stimulated. In order to reach a unity of senses, which Tim Ingold described as synesthesia. I also had physical interaction with water by touching it, blowing into it, or throwing things into it. So my aim was to create a circular flux of intention so that there was a passage of information. So this this methodology tends toward the construction of boundaries, which is followed by a sensation of unity, participation, and attunement, as David Abram described. So, first, it's necessary to introduce the definition of water spaces I used. So, I look at natural water spaces, such as ponds, puddles. lakes, rivers, and the artificial ones, like wells, bowl of water, canal system, water features. I exclude the sea as it has a different characteristic of extension respect of the previous I mentioned. And in general, I use the definition of Catherine D as that water spaces are defined as spaces where water is the predominant element. I will also use the term water skyscape to refer to a skyscape as it looks through water, through water space. So, in the literature, we can find an archetypical correspondence between water and the underworld. For example, if we look at the ancient myth of Ra on the top, the sun god is represented traveling west to east through the underworld with a bark. So as the sun set, then the sun take a bark and travel through the underworld. So there is a watering space below the earth, according to the Egyptian, to this Egyptian myth. And as well as Dante Inferno, the entrance to hell is mediated by a river, the Acheron. And in general, we can find a lot of more examples. But if we take Mircea Eliade, a tripartite model of the cosmos, we can find that the above is represented mainly by the sky, and the middle world is the earth, and the world below is the underworld, that is primarily perceived as watery, or at least the entrance to it is considered watery. Now, to get some example of archaeological material culture on which apply my research, for example, we have ditches around the lithic monuments, and we don't know exactly if they could have embedded any meanings. Or, for example, we have pond barrows, which may represent evidence of collecting water for ritual or funerary purpose. Then we have, in Bronze Age, sacred wells. This is the wells of Santa Cristina. Proverbio Ermaxia, they discovered that the moon is reflected in the water every 18.61 years. Plus, Arnaud Leboeuf argued that the architecture of the well was planned for measuring the moon declination. So we have a strong evidence that this well was constructed to reflect the moon in the water every 18.61 years, which is the major cycle of the moon. Moreover, we have bowls of water. One example is the alabaster bowl in the Central Palace Sanctuary at Knosso, which reflect the light of the sun at the equinox, or in the time frame around the equinox. And according to Mary Bloomberg and Goran Eriksson, there is a quite a lenticular depression of similar sites in the wall, exactly where the reflection takes place. Plus, there are double axis symbol in the wall to define the light of the sun as it enters into the room. Yes, and moreover, we have a new grange. This is a probably similar effect happening. If we look at the Incas culture, there is evidence of the presence of huacas. So huacas are shrines, some of which are natural features of the landscape or carved rock. According to McKill Malville, water and other liquids may have poured into these rocks to animating these sentient beings by empowering them with reflected light. Then there is evidence in the Incas world of of a system of drainage canals which were diverted into sacred spaces and temples to energize them through the act of kamei. If we look at the Morai, that is a royal residency between Cusco and Machu Picchu, there are terrace basins of Morai which are regarded primarily as ceremonial. And for Kimal, with the zenith sun, the light of zenith sun would have passed directly into the Pachamama, or the earth, through the water and empower it. So these are the overview of the literature. And the result I draw from my consideration start with the theme of continuity. In this sense, from my writing, I realized that the water is a band of, the river was a band of water in the pit, in the sky. Oh, sorry. That's the the band of water is a piece of sky within the land. So the river Thames was a continuity of the sky within the land. And in the Hymn of Nile, the river is similarly described as a path that descends from the sky or a way the heaven descending. So in this way, water space is visually allowed to have the heaven on earth. Moreover, as much as water space is delimited, so is the sky containing it. Colin Richard describes water as an element which is able to create physical boundaries. This quality gives water space of precision and enables them to act as a scope where selected celestial phenomena can be observed periodically at specific time. For example, this characteristic is evident in the bowl at the sanctuary of Knosso and at the Sardinian well of Santa Cristina, where water spaces might have been used as calendric devices for this characteristic delimitation of water spaces. And then we have the possibility of manipulation, because water spaces create continuity and delimitation of the sky on the land, the sky can be object of manipulation. For example, in the right picture, the reflection of the moon in the water feature can be noticed. That is just over there. And because of the water feature is covered by a grid, the moon appear in prison. I mean, appear under the grid. So it was a way to have the moon in a prison. I mean, for my observation. And on the other time, as represented on the left picture, the sensation was just to be at one step from the sun, so that I would fall into the sun. Therefore, by the reflection in water, the spaces between the individual and the sky is reduced, and water spaces can become interactive devices between heaven and earth. And in the Greco-Roman literature from the 14th century BC, there are evidence of witches able to draw down the moon, as the image from the vase painting show. So it's not clear in the literature what really does it mean, but this was described first for Thessalian woman, and over time this destructive power had been attributed to this rite as an act of violating the law of nature. So there is speculation on how this Thessalian trick would have been performed, and I suggest that the reflection of the moon in water would have been used for the trick. A further theme is the notion of duality, created by the matching of skyscape and waterscape. This duality created by the reflection and the doubling upside down of the world is very dramatic. And with this hermetic, with this mirroring effect, the hermetic motto, as above, so below, appears to be visually tangible, as the pictures show. But not only shapes, colors, features of the celestial vault are reflected, but also depth. So the depth that is reflected from the sky into the water gives the appearance of being another world. So water spaces appear another world because they reflect depth. And we have an example from Otto Pin developing the Sky Art Manifesto, writing, "The ancient into the sky is mirrored by the ancient into inner spaces as it reflects the cosmos." So from my consideration, the reflection of the sky in water creates a new specular world, which can take the individual on a journey towards the outer and the inner cosmos. So there is a duality outside, inside, that can be drawn from the relationship of skyscape, waterscape. So the next theme is the theme of dissolution. And since the liquid is not completely still, there is this impression that the shapes are not defined. So to give you an example of some writing, "A dance of colors, white, light, blue and green, appearing and disappearing, all mixed up together. It's a joyful dance where everything became one. It is the mystery of reflection, and everything is dissolving into part and mixed up with all the other colors, so that the red of the house has sprinkles of blue sky, and nothing is anymore separable. In the liquid world, nothing is anymore itself. Everything is at the same level. Everything, all the colors and all the shapes, are floating on the same plane." Therefore, since the movement of the water have a visual effect to merge identities, I felt as the border of my own self were dilated. The instability of the fine shape caused the illusion of separated identities to vanish, since everything appeared melting together. Confronted by this vision, I felt as my own self was merged with the rest, with the collective being. According to Carl Gustav Jung, disintegration of the self into the unconscious, or the unknown region of the psyche, corresponds to the journey into the underworld. The same process is described by Michael Washburn as a return to the dynamic ground, since the dynamism is representative of the creative potential of this unknown element. So water spaces can be associated with this state of dissolution of the self into the unconscious, and can give the illusion of a symbolic death experience. And in psychology, this state is described as a thin boundary. So it's a state where you can really leave your own identity and to dislocate your own self into another person or another being or animated object through empathy. So for this reason, according to Eliade, rituals of initiation go through a symbolic death experience by communicating with the underworld. Indeed, not having any identity means having the potentiality of all the identities and therefore the acquisition of new power. In this sense, water spaces suggest access to a transformative status and to the cycle of death and rebirth. And the conclusion, so water skyscapes represent heaven on earth and can be adopted as calendric devices. They make possible the interaction with the sky deities and the sky body, and the sky became possible object of manipulation. Water skyscape represent the dualism inside-outside, and water spaces constitute a reality where the definition of identity are put in debate. The use of water to reflect the sky was possibly integrated with rituals of initiation, where the annihilation of the individual allows the creative process of a new life cycle. And the methodology I use, reflexive phenomenology, has given me new insight and access to a multi-layer narrative, and therefore I argue that is a crucial method of research. And here's some reference. Thank you.